Beijing's Forbidden City. Once the center of an empire, now a tourist playground. This is the new Forbidden City, built on the back of an economic miracle, the hidden world of China's billionaires. Here's one of them, Madame Zhou Zhaoguang, and there are several hundred more dollar billionaires on mainland China.
恭喜发财！恭喜发财！
The billionaires like making money rather than talking about it, but some of them granted us an audience.
60% of this piano is natural jade. Michael Jackson bought it. Then I bought it for millions of dollars.
Welcome to the world of half-million-dollar dogs. Hong Wei Hua is from Shenyang in the northeast. His conglomerate stretches from luxury goods and media to mining and property.
Well, I keep several dogs here. Some of them are quite rare, like the Tibetan Mastiff, which people like pretty much. Well, a white Tibetan Mastiff is rarer, maybe 1 in 10,000. Most are black or yellow.
He likes to show his wealth, but property developer Dai Zi Kang prefers to talk about the influence of the new entrepreneurial class.
The economic world, the leadership should be entrepreneurs. And people gradually understand it and accept it. Maybe not forever, but for this 100 years, will be like that.
This new openness about wealth and its role in such a nuanced society is partly thanks to one man, British-educated Rupert Hugeworth. His company, Hurun, tracks the wealth of the richest 1,000 Chinese.
What I've done is I've broken the taboo about people able to talk about wealth. Now, the number of people that are all taking part in the sort of Fortune Olympics, if you want to use that analogy, and trying to go out and make money, is just about every able-bodied person in China today.
There are two big differences between Chinese billionaires and their Western counterparts. First, they are much younger, with an average age of just 54. Second, almost all of them knew extreme poverty when they were young.
She was a great mother. She used to eat last when the family was very poor in the old days. She usually got nothing to eat in the end. We got something solid to eat, but she only got soup.
Zhong Tinghu is China's richest businessman with a fortune estimated at $12 billion. It comes from his 80% ownership of a soft drinks company, Wahaha.
When I first started in 1987, it was just a little shop in a school, selling popsicles and soft drinks. That's how I started. My family was really, really poor. I had no food to eat, as we were so poor.
What I'm seeing in China at the moment is capitalism at its rawest. You know, I make the comparison to the late 19th century in America, when you got the Morgans, the Rockefellers, they all came up. They then had brilliant ideas and perseverance and a bit of ruthlessness, and today they're household names. This is what's happening in China today.
The difference between American 19th century business barons and today's Chinese billionaires is that the Americans saw the world in terms of rugged individualism. Chinese business leaders like Hong Wei Hua talk in terms of their responsibility to society.
I think responsibility is the first task of a man. Accountability. It's a man's capability to shoulder his responsibility. Then his diligence and indomitableness. Those elements comprise a real man.
This sense of responsibility causes some of the super rich to forfeit enjoyment of their wealth. Zong is an old-style communist, a member of the National People's Congress, the 2,700-member rubber-stamp parliament. He uses his money to further economic growth.
There is an old saying in China, help people in an emergency, but not those who depend on charity. So I help the poor people to get the opportunity to work or start their own business. I don't spend much on food and I don't use much cash. I use the money to invest, to create more jobs, to create more wealth for society, to accomplish my life's goals. I don't have much joy in my life.
In their role as social leaders, the billionaires suggest all sorts of reforms and initiatives to members of the seven-man steering committee that ultimately runs the country. In 2010, Mr. Zong led calls to raise the threshold for paying income tax. It was raised in 2011. In 2009, Madame Zhou harnessed her power and wealth to promote the town of Yiwu. Within 2 years, it became one of the world's top trading posts.
This is the place we first started our business.
Yiwu is an international phenomenon. It has a huge market share in small goods. Its vast wholesale mall, as big as an airport, sells everything from plastic flowers to fax machines to Christmas baubles. Yiwu's new status is an example of the billionaires bringing fresh ideas to the government and outgoing premier Wen Jiabao.
As a deputy to the National People's Congress, I'm the one who put forward the first commerce reform proposal to Premier Wen. But I hadn't expected that Premier Wen would comment on this proposal.
Behind the carefully weighed words of the business leaders and the changes that are commonplace in modern China, there lies one unchanging fact: the all-enveloping power of the Communist Party. Hujaworth believes the connection between wealth and political power is even more evident in China than it is in the West.
We looked at the top 70 people in the Chinese Congress and compared their wealth to the US Congress and found that the top 70 individuals in the Chinese Congress were richer than the entire US Congress, all combined, including the President, and the 13 members of the Supreme Court.
Perhaps the opportunity for corruption is greater in China than elsewhere because of the role of gift-giving, which is intrinsic to Chinese culture.
This is the photograph of all the staff of Zhenge Investment Company. And this is a paperweight from Tang Dynasty. And you can hit any one of us with it if he doesn't behave well. Caning.
Time has proven that none of our gifts to officials were seen as bribes. None during all these years. The method I use is different. And that is how I can avoid unnecessary problems for officials while they get material benefits.
For example, I once gave gifts not only for the benefit of our company, but also to help Shenyang City and even the Liaoning province. 31 important government officials all went to the US, and I paid for their expenses there. I gave the money for expenses, $3 million, to the city government. But if I had given the money to the mayor or the vice mayor, that would be enough to give me problems.
Gift-giving is not the only traditional element of Chinese culture to survive the Maoist period. Religion and superstition are still potent forces at the highest level of Chinese society. With a private temple on the top floor of the family home, Madame Zhou and her husband Yu Yuxin are also devout Buddhists. Entrepreneurs tend to enroll at business schools, partly for networking, but most of them stopped education by the time they were 16. Many are still influenced by superstition and feng shui when making their business decisions. Although Madame Zhou and Mr. Yu had little schooling, Their son Thomas graduated from the London School of Economics. He is leading their online strategy.
Yu's total revenue from Taobao was 50 billion yuan. We sold 10,000 of a single product in one day on the 1st of November last year.
Children of newly wealthy parents are often regarded as too ostentatious, but most of the second generation billionaires I met were as modest and hardworking as their parents.
I just finished my internship.
As they prepare to hand over to the next generation, it seems the billionaires are taking power at the instigation of the party. But if the current system is to be called capitalism, is it possible to have capitalism without democracy?
Would the success of the opening up policy lead to more opening up?
At this moment, it's not a question for open. I think it's another direction now. Open is the word for 20 years ago.
If it's not open, what's the new word? Is it democracy?
No.
What is it then?
Socialism.
New socialism.
Yeah, that means economy for majority, not for the minority.
We never say we belong to capitalism. People have more demands. They want to be much happier and more respected, like our Prime Minister said. That's our mutual goal. Not everyone would do anything to make money, and our system doesn't allow that conduct. Most people make their fortune by hard work.
Mr. Dai talks of the entrepreneur's leadership role. Madame Zhou has transformed her local economy by making Yiwu a global market for small goods. Mr. Zong ushered in a raise in the income tax threshold. So perhaps it is the super rich themselves who are ensuring a future of capitalism without democracy in what will soon be the world's biggest economy.